Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. I think the title of this video will be Fighting the Lordship Heretics. I'm going to try to keep this as short as possible, but it may take a little while to get through this. Those of you who have been following my channel for the last 10 years, you know that I've made many videos already on the subject of fighting against the Lordship salvation heresy, the damnable heresy of Lordship salvation. I've a couple of videos that I've made on this subject already that I hope you'll go watch. Lordship salvation liars. Now, some people could be offended that I am using such strong language to call these people liars. Well, isn't that rude or mean-spirited? But that's how serious this problem is. It needs to be dealt with aggressively. Please watch that video. But for 32 years now, I have been fighting against this damnable heresy, and it's really what salvation boils down to. There's two groups of people in the world. In Romans 10:3, it says there's a group that's trying to establish their own righteousness, so they can present that to God and I hope that their righteousness is good enough and God will accept them. But in Romans 10:3, it says that that's not God's way. God's way is that we embrace the righteousness of Jesus Christ and rely upon that rather than our own righteousness. So there is a tiny, tiny little fraction of humanity who understand and believe this, that our righteousness, no matter how much we try, even the most successful person at establishing their own righteousness, their righteousness is no more than filthy rags in the sight of God. So some of us understand that, the impossibility of making ourselves acceptable to God, and we've come to the conclusion that we're in a helpless, hopeless situation, and we need to be saved. We need a Savior. We need the Savior. Our great Savior God, Jesus, is the only solution, the only hope to this problem. But all the religions of the world are based upon establishing your own righteousness. If you ask people around the world if they believe there's an afterlife and some sort of heaven, and what do you have to do to get there? They think it's earned through personal merit, through our own goodness. If we're just good enough, we'll do it. We'll succeed. All the religions are based upon personal merit, and probably 90% of all professing Christians don't understand the error of that system, the futility of that system. That's why I believe of all the people who identify themselves as some kind of a Christian, probably no more than 10% of them are relying on the righteousness of Christ, the imputed righteousness, rather than counting on their own righteousness. So, years ago I made this video, Lordship Salvation Liars. For 10 years I've been carrying on this fight on YouTube. Really, for 32 years I've been carrying on this fight since I got saved in December of 1986. And the Bible does tell us that this is a fight. Fight this good fight. And it's a battle that we're in. But the reason I'm making this video now is because I believe most of us are not good fighters. I'm sorry to have to tell you this. You don't know how to carry on this fight, most of you. I hope you'll take this as constructive criticism. And it's my hope that you'll learn from this and adopt the ideas I'm going to offer you today and use them. I find, now, some of you don't know me that well, and most of you probably don't know that I've spent also 32 years studying the Bible, but even longer, almost 50 years studying and practicing martial arts. I know a lot about martial arts. I've owned and operated many martial arts schools over the years. And one of the most important principles of any martial art is that the best defense is a good offense. Any martial art, if you're only relying on defending yourself, moving, blocking, covering up, eventually you will succumb to the attacks. You cannot defend all the attacks. You have to be offensive. You have to counterattack. And it's the same thing with argumentation. I believe the big mistake that almost everybody I'm watching on YouTube, the big mistake that's being made is that we are always on the defensive. The Lordship heretic will throw at us all of what they believe are the verses that support their heresy. And we're always defending ourselves, always trying to explain away these, what we would call problem verses. Now, there are good explanations for those verses. And when we take them in context, we can provide an answer. But why should we be on the defensive? I'm going to suggest that we do a fighting technique called the reversal. Let's reverse it on them and put them on the defensive. I've made several other videos over the years trying to teach people some techniques to take the offensive, to take control instead of always having to defend ourselves from the attacks of the Lordship heretic. I hope you'll watch these other videos I'm going to tell you about now. Checkmate a works heretic in 3 moves. It's a pretty short video. It's a little play that I acted out with Brother Frank, who worked closely with me back then. It's probably only 10 minutes long, but I think you'll learn an important strategy from checkmate a works heretic in 3 moves. I also made several videos in a series called The Challenge, and I hope you'll watch that and adopt the techniques I'm offering you in that series of videos. And again, you should understand that it's all based upon putting them on the defensive instead of us having to defend our position. One of the techniques that I hope you'll adopt is we have hundreds of proof texts supporting salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone, and eternal security. I made a series of videos with Brother Jason Jack. It's titled 101 Verses Proving Faith Alone. Now, really, 101 verses is just scratching the surface. We could probably come up with 99 verses just in the Gospel of John, because 99 times we have the word believe being used with nothing else added, like repent. Did you know that believe appears 99 times in the Gospel of John, but the word repent appears 0 times? So the scriptures that support our position are clear, they're explicit, and they're numerous. We need to use these verses, and the best way to use them is not recite them or lecture them or beat them with the verse, but ask them to teach you the meaning of the verse. You could take any of these 101 verses and ask the Lordship heretic, well, it seems that you've studied the Bible, so maybe you can explain this verse to me. And go through it very slowly, because I'm not that smart, so please explain to me, and then cite a verse and have them read it and go through it word by word, like Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for example, or many more. The list of verses are on 101 verses proving faith alone, so you can find the verses there, or if you want, email me, and I'll send you a file of my favorite proof text. And you just offer these verses to the Lordship heretic. Don't try to teach them, because they're really not teachable. What you have to do is you have to make them teach themselves. And you do that by asking them to explain our proof texts. Make them explain it to us. And then when they explain the verse to us, sometimes they will be enlightened, and they'll realize the truth as they read and try to explain our proof text. I also recently made another video asking people to adopt this strategy, and that is when someone says that faith alone, in Christ alone, is insufficient, you've got to also contribute a changed life and some kind of religious works. To actually get saved, they'll say, well, I believe in faith alone, but saving faith is never really alone. That's one of the clever little ways they like to twist it, but really they're still imposing a system of works on the gospel. So if that's the case, we should ask them, show me your resume. That just simply means, would you explain to me all the works that you do every day? Because you're saying that works are necessary to get saved or keep your salvation or prove your salvation. So you must have a very impressive resume. Tell me what you do. What did you do when you woke up this morning and since our conversation today, all day long? What have you done? What kind of works have you done? What works do you do every day? So these are ways that we can reverse this on them and put them on the defensive. And some of these people will be humbled when they're forced to defend themselves and their false doctrine. There's helpful information that I got recently that I want to include in this. This is a comment that was posted on one of my videos from Jonas Grumby. I don't know who Jonas Grumby is. I don't think I've ever had any other comments from Jonas Grumby apart from this one. But I'm going to read this comment, and I'm going to post this comment in the description box of this video. And I hope that you will use everything in this. He wrote, here's 9 questions lordships or works salvationists cannot answer. So these are questions that we need to ask them. Let's reverse this on them. Instead of being pummeled by their questions and accusations, let's reverse on them and ask them these questions. How do you know when you've really believed? Now, when you ask a question, you have to shut up. You don't say another word until they answer it. And if they don't actually answer the question, then you have to post it again and don't go on until they actually answer the question. So ask them, how do you know when you've really believed? After you get that answer, then you say, since your idea of genuine faith must be proved by works and obedience, how do you know your faith qualifies as the real thing, since you can always do and obey more? Now, that statement ends with a question mark. So that means you wait, you stop. You wait for an answer and make them answer the question that was asked instead of changing the subject. This is a weakness in the arguing that I'm seeing going on. We do not insist that they answer our questions, and then we don't insist that they stay on subject. We let them dance around and change the subject. Well, what about this? They'll say, what about this? No, please, I need some answers from you. If your position's correct, if you want to win me over to your side that works are necessary for salvation, then you need to answer my questions. The next question is, what is it that really saves you anyway? Your faith or Jesus, who is the object of your faith? In other words, that there's also a question mark there. So I'm telling you, it's important that you do not just go read one question after another, it's important, essential, mandatory, that you get an answer from them to that specific question. Then another question is, how can your faith be validated by subjective introspection when your feelings and experiences fluctuate? And if the object of your faith, the Lord Jesus Christ, saves you, shouldn't you validate your faith only by whether it rests in Him? Also, how do you know when you've thoroughly repented? Since you are not conscious of every sin, and that is stated in Leviticus 4:2 and 5:15, what if some sins are overlooked and not repented of? Again, every time you pose a question, you have to get an answer. And don't let them change the subject. At what point do you think you've adequately repented? When your attitude changes about the sin? When you resolve to change your conduct? When your conduct actually changes? When you make restitution or ask for forgiveness? Or when you are sure that there will be no repetition of the sin? And if repentance is not just a change of attitude, but a turning from sins and a change in conduct, then why does Jesus tell people to, quote, bear fruits worthy of repentance, unquote? That's Luke 3:8. How do you know when you're completely committed to Christ's Lordship? How much commitment is enough to secure your salvation? Is the willingness to commit enough? Or must you actually commit everything? And how would you know what everything involves, especially as an unbeliever? Since you believe the commitments required for discipleship are also commitments needed for salvation, and they are ongoing, such as deny yourself, take up your cross daily, follow Jesus, abide in God's word, love Christ supremely, etc., how do you know when you have fulfilled them? How can you expect an unbeliever to make spiritual decisions that reflect spiritual maturity and an understanding of God's will? Aren't you getting the cart before the horse? If an unbeliever is dead in sin, how can an unbeliever know and desire what God wants him or her to do and obey? Isn't knowing and obeying God's will the essence of the Christian's life after one believes? Have you remained completely committed to Christ's Lordship? If you haven't, isn't that an indication that you are never fully committed? And wouldn't that mean you are never really saved? Or is it an admission to the reality and power of sin? A reality that would make it impossible for anyone to make the full commitment demanded by your view of salvation. Which sins disqualify a person as a true believer? Again, is there a list of certain sins that prove one is not saved? What about King David's sins of murder and adultery? Since he was surely saved, do sins have to be worse than his to prove one is unsaved? How much sin is a Christian capable of? Since you undoubtedly agree that Christians do sin, how much is too much before you deny he or she is a true Christian? Where do you draw the line? Why does the Bible instruct church discipline for Christians who sin? If salvation depends on your perseverance and faithfulness and good works, how can you know for sure you are saved? Though you may be living faithfully now, how do you know what tests or temptations you will face tomorrow? If you cannot predict the future, isn't there a chance you could sin and die before you repent? As long as that is possible, how can you say with certainty that you are a true Christian and that you have any assurance of eternal life? How could you honestly give assurance of salvation to anyone who says he or she believes the gospel? Where's there room to grow? If your saving faith included obedience, forsaking all sins, a committed life, and a guarantee of faithfulness, what is left to do? Why are there so many ethical demands in the Bible addressed to Christians? Aren't they unnecessary if a godly life is inevitable? Did the Apostle John preach a false gospel? Since the Gospel of John does not mention repentance or submission or commitment to Jesus as Lord as conditions for salvation, but does mention belief as the condition for salvation 98 times. Would you call that easy believism? Do you think John was ignorant or irresponsible? But I know you believe that it is impossible since this is God's inspired word, right? Since his is the only book of the Bible that claims it was written to tell people how to be saved, as stated in John 20, verse 31, shouldn't it determine what you believe about the condition for salvation? All right, so that completes the series of questions suggested by Jonas Grumby. I hope that you've learned from this message today it's my conclusion that almost every person I'm watching dialogue with people teaching a false gospel are letting them pummel them, and they need to reverse it on them and put them on the defensive. And as I said, I've tried to teach you how to do that, this with my videos, Checkmate at Works, Heretic in Three Moves, the Challenge series, 101 verses proving faith alone, Show Me Your Resume. And now I'm giving you all these questions from Jonas Grumby so that you can ask these to the Lordship Heretic and you can take control of the dialogue. All of these things are really meant to accomplish the same thing, to make the Lordship Heretic recognize that their position is absurd, unbiblical, and futile. All right. I'll be very curious to see if someone actually begins to adopt these reversal techniques I'm recommending. I hope you do, and I'm sure you'll be more successful if you do adopt this approach. Thank you for watching. Appreciate everybody's efforts to defend and teach the real gospel. Salvation is a free gift offered to everyone. It's eternal life, and it's guaranteed to all believers, everyone who believes that Jesus did it all for them on the cross. Nothing else is required by them. And that Jesus promises eternal life to all of us who believe in his finished work and his promise of eternal life. All right, thank you, and bless you all in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus.